suppose if there is a, what you can say, like Article 39 says that the state shall try to create such economic system where all the economic resources are equitably distributed among the citizens of India. So to implement that DPSP, Indira Gandhi was the prime minister, and she has decided to, what you can say, take the land from the zamindars or the people who are having, what you can say, the excess land. So take land from them and give it to the landless laborers or the marginalized farmer who have less, what you can say, the land. So to implement this DPSP, there was a clash between the right to property, because as per those zamindars, they were saying that right to property is our fundamental right, and our property cannot be taken away by the state and given it to the landless labor. So the case went to the Supreme Court, and Supreme Court said, but what Indira Gandhi did at that time, Indira Gandhi has passed an amendment into the constitution saying that by removing Article 31 as a right to property, she repealed it. Now the question arises, can the fundamental right be removed? So at that time, Supreme Court said that, yes, any part of the Constitution of India can be removed, can be amended, can be, what you can say, repealed, provided it is not going to hamper on the basic structure of the Constitution of India. And again, Supreme Court interpreted that the right to property is not a basic structure of the Constitution of India. So in this case, we knew that there was a clash between DPSP and fundamental right, and here the DPSP prevailed, right? And again, you need to know why DPSP prevails over the fundamental right sometimes, because DPSPs are for the benefit of the larger section of the society, while the fundamental rights are for the rights of an individual. Right, so fundamental rights are the rights of the individual, while the DPSPs can benefit to the larger section of the society. So it depends whether the Supreme Court, how the Supreme Court interprets that particular, what you can say, the case. So sometimes the fundamental rights, what you can say, have been, what you can say, ignored to implement the DPSPs, and sometimes some very basic fundamental rights are there which have been, what you can say, kept as it is. So you cannot say, what you can say, categorically, that whether the DPSP prevails or fundamental rights prevails. Actually, both complement with each other. So, because fundamental rights gives rights to the citizens of India, while the DPSPs are the guidelines given to the state, both are, what you can say, are supposed to, what you can say, give protection to the citizens of India in terms of, what you can say, welfare of the people. So you cannot say that whether the DPSP prevails over fundamental right or not, or fundamental rights prevails over the DPSP or not. Sometimes to implement some of the DPSPs, you have to ignore the violation of the fundamental rights, and sometimes to give the right to the fundamental right, DPSP should have to be ignored. Right? For example, because many people are arguing that the Uniform Civil Code, what you can say, violates the Article 25. Right, so that is why you may say that one of the important argument for not implementing the Uniform Civil Code is that, according to few people, that it violates the fundamental right of religious freedom. So this is the case. So depends whether depend upon that case, whether which will prevail, whether the fundamental right will prevail or whether the DPSP will prevail. It depends upon the context, and it is the Supreme Court which has to take a decision on it. Fine,
sir.
Yes.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Sir, in 86th Amendment Act 2002. Hello, sir.
Yes, can you hear me? Yes, I can hear you. Continue.
Changed the subject matter of Article 45 in DPSP and made elementary education as a fundamental right.
Right.
Under Article 21A.
Right.
So what you will say about that, sir? So your opinion on this? So
fundamental right, and you're talking about fundamental duties, right?
Yeah, yes, sir.
See, what happens under Article 21, it is a fundamental right of the child between 6 and 14 to get the free and compulsory, that is elementary education. If the state fails to provide the education, then the state has to provide it. But suppose, as it is the duty of the parents to send their child to the school between 6 and 14, and if suppose parent do not send a child to the school, so can you file a case against the parent?
No,
you cannot file the case against the parent, because it is a fundamental duty, and we know that fundamental duties are not, what you can say, enforceable in the court. But suppose, yes, if the child wants to go to the school And if the state fails to provide school or if the state fails to provide teacher, then that child can go to the court and ask the state to provide the school as well as the education. So that is what is the difference under Article 21A and the 11th fundamental duty, which is added in the fundamental duty chapter. Got it? Why it has been added in two different areas? Because as per Article 21A, it is the obligation of the state to provide free education, free and compulsory education between 6 and 14 age of the child. And it is the duty of the parents to send the children. But if the parent do not send the children to the school, they cannot be, what you can say, the case cannot be filed against the parent. But suppose if the state fails to provide the education to the child, then that child can go to the court and ask the state to provide it. So fundamental rights are for the state, right? So it is an obligation of the state to follow the fundamental rights. Clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other doubt? Okay, so shall I go to the today's plan?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Sure. So today we have certain topics which will be I will be discussing with you. So I want you to study Parliament of India, the structure and composition and functioning of the Parliament of India. That's what you need to know. I don't think questions can be asked about the structure and about the composition, but yes. I have seen that in last 2-3 years, the questions have been asked about the functions of the parliament in India, right? So Parliament of India, the second topic is parliamentary system in India. Parliamentary system, I have seen that last 2-3 years continuously, the questions have been asked about the parliamentary system in India. How, what is the best, what you can say, the interpretation of the parliamentary system in India, what happens in the parliamentary system in India. That has been question have been asked previously in 2017, 18 and 19. And that is why I want you to study this. Parliamentary committees, yes, we have seen some questions have been asked about the various parliamentary committees which have been created while functioning as a parliament. Then parliamentary forum, there are various parliamentary forums that has also been excluded. And the budget in parliament, how the budget is passed in the parliament, the questions can be asked. Although it was not in the news in the last year, but you just read it out for the sake of reading. Suppose if there is any questions related to the budget in the parliament, you should be able to solve this question. Next is grants and funds in the Indian budget. So various types of grant like vote on ground, then appropriation bill, then we also have that interim budget. So although there was no interim budget presented in this year, so whenever the interim budget is presented at the end of the Lok Sabha, UPSC do ask questions related to interim budget. Although interim budget has not been introduced this year, but just read for knowing what is the meaning of interim budget and what is vote on account, then vote for grants, that you need to know. Then amendment, yes, in amendment also you need to know what is the process of the amendment of the Constitution of India and what are the important amendments of the Constitution of India, that you need to know about it, right? And amendment of the Constitution of India, you can also read about the basic structure. Can you amend each and every part of the Constitution of India or not? And what are the various judgments given regarding the amendment procedure of the Constitution of India? That also you can read it here. Then bills, various types of bills. Yes, the questions have been asked in the previous exam. Bills like what is the difference between government bill, private member bill, who can introduce the government member bill, who can introduce the private member bill, then money bill, finance bill, constitution amendment bill. There are various types of bills which can be passed into the parliament. So you need to know what are the types of the bills and how they are passed, what majority is required, what would you consider the support is required. That all you need to know. Who can introduce it? And if it is not passed, what happens, that you need to know in this particular topic. Elections in India, why I have included these elections in India? Because we have seen that last year, there was one question in UPSC, which says that there was a statement in previous exam, which says that to get elected to the Lok Sabha, the candidate must secure more than 50% of the total votes were voted. So the statement is correct or wrong, that question was asked. So what do you think, the statement is correct or wrong? I'm giving a statement that to be declared as elected to the Lok Sabha, the candidate must secure more than 50% of the total votes voted. So the statement is correct or wrong?
Wrong, sir.
This is a wrong statement. Why it is wrong? Can anyone tell me why this statement is wrong?
In India, we have the first-past-the-post election system.
Sorry?
In India, we have the first past the post-election system.
Yeah, we have FPTP system, right? So in FPTP system, it is not necessary to secure 50% of the total votes. In FPTP method, you need to score, you need to, what you can say, score majority of the votes, right? So that is why if you know that basic thing, you may say that this statement is wrong, right? Again, like the questions have been asked related to the election of the MPs, election of the president, election of the vice president, election of what you can say, the MLAs, right? So we have seen that yesterday's question where it is mentioned that the value of the vote of the MP and the value of the vote of the MLAs are differ or same or more or higher. Such type of questions are being asked in the last 2-3 years. So that is why I have given you this, topic, elections in India, how the elections are conducted, who conducts the election. Apart from this, how the election to the various posts are, what you can say, taken place, that you need to know. So president, vice president, then MPs and MLAs, MPs of Rajya Sabha, MLAs of the Legislative Council, if they are available in any state, that you need to know the process of election. Got it? Then anti-defection law. I have included this anti-defection law because anti-defection was in news a lot in this year, whether it was in Karnataka or whether it was in Rajasthan or whether it is in Madhya Pradesh. We have seen that many MLAs have defected their original party and have joined to the opposition party. So I'm expecting a question on anti-defection law this year. Many explanations have been given into the Indian Express last year in this vertical scene, one complete year. So what is being given in anti-defection law, that also you need to see. At the same time, you also go through the Indian Express explanation about the anti-defection law. Fine? So can anybody tell me who decides about the qualification and disqualification about the MLAs in case of defection? Who decides?
Speaker.
Yeah, speaker of Lok Sabha, and in case of Legislative Assembly, Speaker of Legislative Assembly. Like we have seen, we are now seeing that, yeah, I guess maybe today the Rajasthan Legislative Assembly Speaker will take a decision about the qualification and disqualification of the MLAs who have, what we can say, left the Congress, right? So that basic things you need to know about the anti-defection law. So this year, I'm expecting a question on anti-defection law. I'm expecting questions on elections as well. Fine? Then high courts in India, that you need to see. High courts and subordinate courts in judicial, right? That you need to know. High courts as well as Supreme Court of India. Supreme Court of India, how the judges are appointed, what are the functions of the Supreme Court of India, what are the roles of the Supreme Court of India, and what are the roles of High Court, what are the functions of High Court, how the judges of the Supreme Court of India are appointed. So all these things you need to finish today. So I have given you a few topics today. So you have to finish all these topics. And if you have any doubts while reading these topics, you can ask me. And you also have to go through the previous year questions on these particular topics from 2014 onwards. Fine? The source from where you will read it?
Okay, sir.
The same source, that is, you can do it from 11th standard NCERT. In 11th standard NCERT, there are two particular topics. One is the judiciary, and the legislature is also one topic. And in PM Lakshmikant also, you can read it out. And you can also go through the Jagran Josh website where the basic information is given in a very lucid manner. Fine. So any doubts about the today's topic?
Any doubt? No, sir.
Take care. So shall we discuss few questions of the previous year?
Sir.
Yes, Rahina, boliye.
Sir, ek question tha.
Boliye.
लॉ एक्ट और बिल में क्या फर्क रहता है? कभी बोलते कि एक्ट है, कभी बोलते लॉ है. समझ में नहीं आता मुझे.
ठीक है. बिल मतलब ये होता है कि जब भी कोई कानून बनाने के लिए जब पार्लियामेंट में कोई एक ड्राफ्ट जब इंट्रोड्यूस किया जाता है तो उसको बिल कहा जाता है. व्हेन अ ड्राफ्ट इज इंट्रोड्यूस्ड इनटू द पार्लियामेंट देन इट इज कॉल्ड एज बिल. सो वंस इट इज पास्ड इन बोथ द हाउस, व्हेन इट इज पास्ड इन बोथ द हाउस और उसके बाद जब फाइनली प्रेसिडेंट का जब उसको असेंट मिलता है, व्हेन प्रेसिडेंट साइंस दैट इज इन पास्ड इन बोथ द हाउसेस एंड एज पर द प्रोसीजर व्हेन द प्रेसिडेंट गिव्स एन असेंट टू दैट व्हाट यू कैन से दैट ड्राफ्ट देन इट इज कॉल्ड एज एक्ट. सो जब वो जो कानून होता है, जब वो प्रोसेसिंग में होता है, जब वो बनने के मतलब इन द मिडल ऑफ व्हाट यू कैन से द प्रोसेसिंग व्हेदर इट इज इंट्रोड्यूस्ड इन लोकसभा और राज्यसभा, तब उसको हम बिल कहते हैं. जब वो फाइनली प्रेसिडेंट का जब उसको असेंट मिलता है तो उसके बाद उसको एक्ट कहा जाता है. What is Rohina?
फिर law किसको बोलते हैं sir?
Law और act are same. Law and acts are same. Law और act में कुछ फर्क नहीं है. समझ में आ गया? ठीक है. So one second. So let me go to the previous polity questions. We will discuss 2017 questions today. Every day I will be discuss one year question so that you will be able to, what you can say, understand the tone of the UPSC questions. Can you all see the screen? Is it visible to all of you? Screen is visible, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So yesterday we have discussed about the 2018 questions. Today we will discuss 2017 questions. Yes. So they are very interesting questions which we are asking 2017. So the trend has changed from 2017 onwards again. Okay. Here there is one question called, in India, judicial review implies. That is the question here. Right. So judicial review का मतलब क्या होता है इंडिया में, ये क्वेश्चन पूछा गया है, right?
Sir, I'm not visible.
You can't see it? Is it visible?
No,
now?
Sir.
Sir, screen is not visible.
No, screen is not visible. Sir.
One second. Okay, can you see it now? Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, so in 2017, as I told you that the trend of asking the questions have changed now. So this is a fine example how the UPSC is asking the question now. So in India, judicial review implies. So what implies means, what is the meaning of judicial review? That was the question asked in 2017. So first option is that the power of the judiciary to pronounce upon the constitutionality of laws and executive orders. So whether the order which is given by the executive and whether the laws which has been passed by the legislature, to check it out the constitutionality, I mean whether it is as per the provision of the Constitution of India or not, that is what the Supreme Court or the power of the judiciary to check it out. So is it called as a judicial review? That was the question. Second, the power of the judiciary to question the wisdom of the laws enacted by the legislature. And C, the power of the judiciary to review all the legislative enactments before they are assented to by the president. And D, the power of the judiciary to review its own judgments given earlier in similar or different cases. So what is the answer? It's a very easy question actually, but many students get trapped in exam hall. They go to cancer, they get confused. They mark D also as a answer, or वो एक ट्रैप हो जाता है एग्जाम में अंडर प्रेशर, यू माइट व्हाट यू कैन से गेट कंफ्यूज्ड हियर. सो व्हाट इज द आंसर ऑफ दिस क्वेश्चन?
यस सर, फर्स्ट वन,
राइट. सो द इन इंडिया जुडिशियल रिव्यू मींस व्हाट? द सुप्रीम कोर्ट ऑफ इंडिया कैन चेक द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल वैलिडिटी. कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल वैलिडिटी मींस व्हाट? कि व्हाटएवर द लॉ इज पास्ड इन द पार्लियामेंट ऑफ इंडिया, वेदर इट इज एज पर द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन और नॉट, दैट व्हाट आवर जुडिशियरी चेक्स इट आउट, एंड दैट इज व्हाट इज कॉल्ड अ जुडिशियल रिव्यू, राइट. So the D statement is also correct. The power, the judiciary has the power to, what you can say, review its own judgments given in earlier or similar or different cases. But that is not called a judicial review. It is what you can say, review of its own judgment, right? And option B, that is the power of the judiciary to question the wisdom of the laws enacted by the legislature. So do you think that our judiciary can question the wisdom of the lawmakers? Can our judiciary question the wisdom of the MPs of the Parliament of India or MLAs of the Legislative Assembly? Do you think this is correct or wrong? They cannot question it. They cannot question the wisdom of the laws enacted by the legislature. So that is why B statement is wrong. Three statement is also wrong. Why? Because there is no need of taking the, what you can say, the views of the views or review of the law which is passed by the parliament, by the judiciary. Yes, judicial review may happen only after the assent of the president is taken and not before that. So in that sense, C is also wrong. So A is the correct answer in this question. So you got it. Nowadays such type of questions are asked by the UPSC increasingly, and that is what is mentioned as the the trend which is changed in last year, right? So there is one more question here. Yes. So yes, for election, like why I have included the topic election, because I am seeing that the last 2-3 years continuously the questions have been asked about the elections, various types of elections in India. So one is, for election to the Lok Sabha, a nomination paper can be filed by not anyone residing in India. Is it correct or wrong? Anyone residing in India? Is it correct or wrong? Can anyone residing in India file the nomination for the Lok Sabha?
No.
No.
Anyone residing means anyone means a foreigners may also reside in India. So can he file the nomination to election of the president of India?
No.
Sorry, Lok Sabha in India? No. So the A statement is wrong. Second, a resident of the constituency from which the election is to be contested. So is it compulsory that you have to contest the election from where you are, what you can say, you are contesting the elections, you have to be the resident of that particular constituency? This is also
No, sir.
Can contest Lok Sabha election from any part of the country, in any constituency, right? The best example, can you give me the best example that a person who contested the elections not belonging to that particular constituency?
Prime Minister Narendra Modi.
Yes. Right? So he contested the election from Varanasi. He's a resident of Gujarat. And again, you can see he has, he is the resident of the Gandhinagar. But in spite of that, he contested the election in Varanasi. Right? Best example, again, Rahul Gandhi. He contested election from Wayanad districts. Wayanad districts in Kerala. Like many people, like even Sonia Gandhi is the resident of Delhi. She's contesting the elections in Raibareli. Right? Smriti Irani is a resident of Mumbai. She has contested the election from Banaras. So it is not compulsory. See, any citizen of India whose name papers are in electoral roll of a constituency, and D, any citizen of India. So D is also wrong. Can anybody tell me why any citizen of India is wrong?
Because the 25 ke abo age limit hai na iske.
Yes, that is also. And apart from this, not all any citizens of India can contest the election. There are some other conditions also, apart from being any citizen of India. So C, any citizen of India whose name appears in the electoral roll of a constituency. So when you file the nomination, you have to give the number in the electoral roll, that on which number your name is, what you can say, is enrolled. If your name is not enrolled in the Lok Sabha constituency, you cannot contest the election. It means what? You have to complete your 25 years of age to contest the election. Got it? So
yes.
Answer C is correct here. So now I'm seeing that repeatedly the UPSC is asking questions related to the elections, like elections of Lok Sabha. Here the question was related to what are the conditions, but in the next year they have asked about how a person can get elected, like what is the number of votes he should secure. That was the question asked. So that's why I want you to study election in India thoroughly, so that if there is any questions in the coming exam, you should be able to solve that question. Like here the question number 2, it's mentioned here that in the election of Lok Sabha or state assembly, the winning candidate must get at least 50% of the votes put to be declared elected. The statement is correct or wrong that you have been asked. So the statement is wrong, which I have already discussed now. Second statement, according to the provisions laid down in the Constitution of India, in Lok Sabha, the speaker post goes to the majority party and the deputy speaker's post goes to the opposition. So whether this statement is correct or wrong. Hello.
Wrong.
Yes, Bagisha, whether this statement is correct or wrong, I want you to answer this question.
So it's wrong.
It's wrong. Why it is wrong?
Sir, because there is no provision. In fact, jab Morarji Desai ki sarkar thi, us time se aisa ek cheez ho gaya tha jo unhone jo hai wo position deputy speaker ko de di thi, deputy speaker ko. To tab se ek tarike ka wo provision chala aa raha hai, lekin aisa condition mein kahin mention nahi hai ki
constitution mein nahi hai. It is not laid down in Constitution of India. That is why here specifically UPSC mentioned that according to the provisions laid down in the Constitution of India. Right? So now you can see in Lakshmikant, it is mentioned that ki the post of the deputy speaker goes to the opposition and the post of the speaker goes to the majority party. That is what is mentioned in the Lakshmikant. So most of the people, what they do, they read Lakshmikant and the people believe that ki Lakshmikant is the Constitution of India and they attempt the questions and they get it wrong. Because unhone kahin na kahin Lakshmikant mein padha hota hai ki Lakshmikant mein ye likha tha ki स्पीकर की पोस्ट मेजोरिटी पार्टी को चली जाती है और डेप्यूटी स्पीकर की पोस्ट अपोजिशन को चली जाती है, पड़ा हुआ होता है. एंड दैट इज व्हाई दे गेट इट रॉन्ग. एंड यूपीएससी नोज इट वेरी वेल दैट मेजी पीपल्स आर रीडिंग लक्ष्मीकांत, सो दिस इज एक्चुअली अ ट्रैप क्वेश्चन. सो मेनी, सो व्हाट यू कैन से, द कैंडिडेट्स गॉट इट रॉन्ग हियर बिकॉज दे हैव अटेम्प्टेड, दे हैव व्हाट यू कैन से मार्क्ड सेकंड स्टेटमेंट एज अ करेक्ट स्टेटमेंट. So you need to always remember that you don't need to follow what is mentioned in Lakshmikant. You need to follow what is mentioned in the Constitution of India. That is why specifically UPSC has mentioned here that according to the provisions laid down in the Constitution of India, In Lok Sabha, the speaker post goes to the majority party and the deputy speaker goes to the opposition. Whether this statement is correct or not, that I've asked, and this statement is wrong because there is nothing mentioned as such in the Constitution of India regarding whether the speaker should be go to the majority party or not. But it is mentioned in the Constitution of India that the speaker should be elected among the member of the Lok Sabha. That is what is mentioned in the Constitution of India. Got it? So how the UPSC is framing the questions, how they are trying to trap you in the statement. Clear? In first statement, they have checked your basic understanding. Yeah. And in the second statement, they are trying to trap you. So you need to understand this in exam hall. Clear? Check it. Going to the next question. Right to vote and to be elected in India is what type of right? This is again one of the very easy questions. But many students, many candidates have got it wrong in this question. So, जब question बहुत easy लगता है, तो समझ लीजिए कि उसमें कुछ ना कुछ trick है या उसमें कुछ ना कुछ trap है. You have to what you can say very careful while attempting easy questions. जब भी आपको लगता है कि कोई question easy लग रहा है, you have to give a second thought before attempting your answer. Right? So, right to vote and to be elected in India is a which type of right? Whether it is a fundamental right, or natural right, or constitutional right, or legal right. So what do you think? What type of right it is? Is it a fundamental right? आप लोगों ने fundamental right कल किया था. So is right to vote and elected is mentioned in the fundamental right chapter of the Constitution of India?
No.
No, sir.
It is not.
No, sir.
Is it natural right? You need to know what is the difference.
No, sir.
Well, you need to know what is the difference between natural right, constitutional right, and fundamental right, and legal right. Right? So, can anybody explain me what are the difference between all these types of rights? Quickly, just within just 1 minute, agar koi explain kar sakta hai mujhe. What is the difference between legal right, constitutional right, natural right, and fundamental right?
So, natural rights are the rights which are provided by birth. They are by birth given, and it is under, I guess, U.S. Constitution, natural rights.
Is citizenship in India is a natural right? Is citizenship in India is a natural right? Is citizenship in India is a natural right?
No, sir.
If you are born in India,
yes,
can you get the citizenship of India?
Yes, sir. Natural right.
Yes, there is an option of that acquisition of citizenship of India by what you can say by birth also you can get it, right? So,
yes, sir, yes.
By natural, you can get it. Okay, fine. Carry on, Zainab. You are right, actually, that natural rights are what you can say you get when you get born. Second, fundamental rights.
Fundamental rights are the rights which are just provided in the...
we have lost her. Yes. Can anybody else continue? Yes, Chandrasekhar, you are saying something.
So fundamental rights are the rights of an individual. And
natural rights are also rights of individual. It can also be rights of individual.
But the fundamental rights are, it gives liberty and everything, the freedom. Like that, it goes like that. But a natural right is, completely depending upon the particular country, the sovereignty of the nations, like that.
No, your concept is
sir, not fundamental right. Rights, natural. Wo hote hain jo hamare paas hote hain, jinke liye hum state ke ko claim kar sakte hain if we are not getting it. Natural rights, wo hote hain jo hum kisi law wagaira
se. Legal right mein bhi aap kar sakte ho. Agar legal right agar aapko nahi mil raha hai, to bhi aap स्टेट के अगेंस्ट में जाकर केस कर सकते हो. कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल राइट भी अगर आपको नहीं मिल रहा है तो भी आप स्टेट के अगेंस्ट में जाकर कर सकते हो.
बट सर कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन गारंटी नहीं करता, सिर्फ फंडामेंटल को गारंटी करता है. वी आर हैविंग द प्रोविजन जिसमें लिखा हुआ है कि अगर फंडामेंटल राइट वॉयलेट होता तो हम कर सकते हैं.
वही मैं पूछ रहा हूँ कि फंडामेंटल राइट किसको कहा जाता है. यू आर सेइंग कि फंडामेंटल राइट अगर वायलेट होता है तो हम सुप्रीम कोर्ट में जाकर उसको क्या कर सकते हैं, उसको गारंटी ले सकते हैं. बट व्हाट फंडामेंटल राइट्स आर. Simple, my simple question. It's a very simple thing. Those rights which are enlisted in the part 3, that is in fundamental rights chapters, are fundamental right. उसके अलावा भी कुछ राइट्स हैं कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन में, उसके अलावा भी कुछ राइट्स हैं कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन में जो दिए गए हैं, उनको हम फंडामेंटल राइट नहीं कहेंगे, उनको कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल राइट कहेंगे, राइट। तो फंडामेंटल राइट्स मतलब वो राइट्स हैं जो पार्ट थ्री में जो स्पेसिफिकली मेंशन किए गए हैं, उनको हम फंडामेंटल राइट्स कहेंगे। समझ में आ गया, बेसिक इतना ही डिफरेंस है उसमें। और कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल राइट्स ऐसे राइट्स हैं जो अपार्ट फ्रॉम दिस फंडामेंटल राइट्स हमारे कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन में दिए गए हैं, दोज आर कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल राइट्स। एंड लीगल राइट मींस व्हाट, कि द राइट्स व्हिच यू गेट व्हेन द लॉ इज पास्ड इन द पार्लियामेंट। तो लॉ पास करके जो राइट्स मिलते हैं उसको लीगल राइट कहा जाता है। जैसे कि फॉर एग्जाम्पल राइट टू व्हाट यू कैन सी राइट टू जॉब, राइट टू जॉब, राइट टू जॉब है, मनरेगा एक्ट है, महात्मा गांधी नेशनल रूरल एम्प्लॉयमेंट गारंटी एक्ट। So as per this act, you have a legal guarantee of getting 100 days jobs in a year. If you do not get it, you can go and ask for a legal justice. So legal right में और fundamental right में difference ये है कि legal right में आपको you have to follow the normal course of law, and in fundamental right you can directly go to the Supreme Court. That is what is the difference between legal right, constitutional right, natural rights and fundamental rights. So now tell me, the right to vote, to be elected in India, ये fundamental right में है? Is it there in the fundamental right? Fundamental right वाले चैप्टर में है बगीशा? Is it there in the fundamental?
No.
It is not there.
No sir.
Is it natural right? Can anybody get the right to vote and to be elected in India as a natural right?
No.
There are certain limitations also, right? Not everybody gets the right to vote. Right? Second, is it constitutional right? हमारे constitution में as like the people have been given, or citizens of India has been given right to contest election, right to contest the election,
yes,
for the president, yes, for the president, for MP,
yes,
for MLAs, right? And legal right? Legal right? No, it is a
yes, sir. It is. Sir, it is also a legal right, it but the legal answer आएगा, constitutional right will prevail.
Yeah, constitutional right will prevail. Right?
सर लेकिन पहले के कॉन्टेक्स्ट में कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल राइट है, लेकिन अगर अभी के सेंस में हम देखें जो जितने सारे जो भी अभी रिसेंटली जजमेंट्स आए हैं उस हिसाब से वी कैन आल्सो राइट लीगल राइट्स। अब आज के कॉन्टेक्स्ट में अगर हम देखते हैं तो हम लीगल राइट मार्क कर सकते हैं और सही होगा।
ठीक है, ओके दैट्स फाइन। अगेन सी, अगर आप लॉयर होते बगीचा तो सुप्रीम कोर्ट में या कोर्ट के सामने आप कोई भी आर्ग्यूमेंट कर सकते थे, बट अगेन नाउ यू आर अपीयरिंग फॉर यूपीएससी। अभी हमको यहाँ पे यस you have like king lawyer kya ho sakta hai na ki there can be a different interpretation of the even the laws, but anyways humko kya dekhna hai ki upsc ne kya answer diya hai ye humko dekhna hai yahan pe। So this is again a 2018 question, yes, I guess upsc ki 2018 ka hai, to 2018 ka official answer ki you can go through it and just check it out what is the answer of this question। But anyways ek aadh do question hota hai jahan pe ambiguity hoti hai, jahan par like every person's articles the interpretation can be different, but as per the upsc I guess constitutional right is the correct answer of this question।
Fine? Yes, sir.
Now here you can see that all the questions here, majority of the questions which have been asked in the previous particular year are related to the election. Like you can see from the first question, like in the first question was related to election of Lok Sabha, second question was related to the numbers which you should get to get elected, right to vote and get elected is a right. Then again, question number four is also the questions related to election, right? So why this question was asked? Because that was in the news at that time, right? So question 4, the Election Commission of India is a 5-member body. So the statement is correct or wrong. So what could be the likely mistake in this statement?
Whether it is 3-member body.
Whether it is a 5-member body or whether it is a more member body or less member body, that you need to know. So the
it is a 3-member body.
Yeah, right now it is a 3-member body, right? Right now. Second, you see here, they have not mentioned as per the Constitution of India, it is a 5-member body. ऐसे नहीं लिखा है यहाँ पे। What they have mentioned that the Election Commission of India is a 5-member body. The statement is wrong. Second, Union Ministry of Home Affairs decides the election schedule for the conduct of both general election and by-election. The statement is correct or wrong? Who decides about the
yes, sir.
Wrong.
About the election schedule and election dates? Is it Home Minister?
Election Commission.
Election Commission. That is why I have included the election topic today, because questions have been asked about the process of election in India. And even if you are reading newspaper regularly, you will come to know that whenever the elections are declared, they are declared by the Election Commission of India by taking a press conference. So if you know that basic thing when you are reading newspaper, you can discard second statement as a wrong statement. and five statement also you can discard if you are seeing the press conference, because in press conference only three members comes to give the press conference, then also you can find out the answer of these questions. Even you don't need to read the PM Bakshi or you don't need to read Lakshmikant for finding out this question. Third statement, Election Commission resolves the dispute relating to the splits and merger of the recognized political parties. So whether this statement,
yes, sir.
But anyways, if you know about the first statement and second statement, you can find out the answer. So first statement is wrong. If first statement is wrong, you can eliminate first option. If second statement is wrong, you can eliminate second option also, third option also, because two is there in A, B and C. So you can eliminate it, and three only you can mark it correct. Even if you don't know whether the merger or split of the political parties are recognized by the Election Commission of India or not. Got it? So that is why here the UPSC is helping you in what you can say framing option in such a way that that UPSC is expecting you to know about the first statement and second statement. In fact, second statement ke bare mein zyada hai, because again first statement thoda sa factual bhi ho sakta hai. Many people may not be knowing about whether it is a five member body or not. But second statement, if you are watching the videos or sorry conferences or reading newspaper, you will be very sure that the elections are not declared by the Union Home Minister. It is declared by the what it gets the Election Commission of India. So if the second statement is wrong, here you can see the second statement is in option A and B and C. So you can eliminate these three options and you can mark three only, even if you don't know about first statement and three statement. So got it how UPSC does it? UPSC always like helps to those people who have a general awareness. Zyada padhai likhai karne ki zarurat nahi. Those who have people have a general awareness, they can also easily solve the questions of UPSC by using some logic and by using some what you can say the common sense. Fine. So question we have discussed these questions. We have discussed about these questions also, which of the following are not necessarily the consequence of the yes. See here, you can see yesterday we have discussed about the proclamation of the emergency. Here, the same topic, but the question has been framed in a different way. So, which of the following are not necessarily the consequences of proclamation of president's rule in a state? First, dissolution of the state legislative assembly. This is wrong. Removal of the council of ministers in the state. Yes. If the president rule is imposed, it means that the removal of the council of ministers is there. Then third, dissolution of the local bodies. Do you think the local bodies are dissolved when the president rule is, what you can say, imposed in a state? Is it dissolved? Local bodies like Mahanagar Palika, Gram Panchayat, Panchayat Samiti, are they dissolved? They are not dissolved.
No, they are not dissolved.
So three is a wrong statement, and what you can say, not necessarily. Here it is a negative statement. Which of the following are not necessarily the consequences of the proclamation? No? So not necessarily one and three. So answer should be one and three. Got it? Any doubts about this question? Hello, am I audible to all of you? Check it.
Yes, sir.
So, sir, you are audible.
So in this way, the UPSC is framing the question. So I have left with 1 minute. So we will stop here now. So you go through the questions once again to just get an idea how the UPSC is framing the questions. Here there is a question, which of the following are envisaged by the right against exploitation in the
country?
Yeah. There are questions which are framed by UPSC. So jitna zyada previous year question paper ko dekhoge, utna zyada aapko focusedly preparation karne mein samajh mein aa jayega. So that is what I like. Before starting any revision, you should read previous year question paper. It should be like daily what you can say the task of you. It should be like religiously, jaise subah mein uthkar aap puja karte ho ya namaz padhte ho, usi tarah se roz question paper dekhna should be your worshipping while preparing for UPSC. Fine. So we'll stop here. We'll continue tomorrow. And if you have any doubts about whatever you are going to read today, we will have a discussion in tomorrow's class. Fine. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
And I hope that all of you are getting all of you are like beneficial. Ho raha hai aapko whatever session I'm taking to you while revising and also.
Yes, sir.